So there will be some course here on very wide topic, and we'll see many subjects. And it's a bit related to some course which I gave 2 years ago, but it's a big development, and yeah, we'll see what is it. So we'll talk about quantization, and I'll just start with kind of very historically from. Unitary quantization from quantum mechanics. Yeah, this is something which I want to say it's really not a precise statement, it's some kind of symplectic statement, it's very fuzzy. So the construction is not really canonical. So we start with real, like C infinity symplectic manifold. And what the quantization says that to this manifold we should associate a complex Hilbert space. H, which something which depends on manifold and symplectic structure. And a Lagrangian submanifold should give roughly a vector CL in H. And if one look on in examples, the details, in fact, it's Lagrangian manifold should be slightly enhanced. One adds some extra data. For example, one should have half density. And some rho. And vector depends on rho. And maybe square of norm of this vector will be integral of Lagrangian over square of rho, which is density, so it will be some positive number. Yeah, that's a kind of rough picture, and I'll just what are basic examples. First example, an axis, just Euclidean space, R to dimension 2D, and omega is one over h bar times standard form. H bar will be a small parameter on which everything depends. Yeah, so secretly one can try to see this omega is 1 over h bar, some kind of standard form. In general, then the Hilbert space is L2 of Rd with coordinate x. And L2, again, understood not as function but half densities. On coordinate subspace in x coordinates, or I can write it in y coordinates. And via Fourier transform. And the kernel for Fourier transform should be exponent. And maybe I'll put square root minus not to mix with indices. You divide the probability I over h bar. Yeah. And if Lagrangian manifold is graph of differential of some function, the function is from r dx to r, real valued function, then and also gets this half density. Then C of L rho will be exponent of I f over h bar, f of h bar. Now I is square root of minus 1 because I don't this is, and then you can see the I project my Lagrangian manifold to RDX and take direct image of this half density. Yeah, that's you get some function. Yeah, so it's how this all looks in non-compact case, and in compact case, I'll just stay with one example. X will be sphere, and now h bar will be 1 over integer, so it will be some quantization condition, not any Planck constant in a compact case works. And then omega will be 1 over h bar omega 0. Yeah, omega 0 it's area form on sphere divided by 2. So we see that integral of omega is equal to 2 pi n. And corresponding Hilbert space is Cn. And Lagrangian manifolds, not again, not every Lagrangian manifold will be quantized, should be again some quantization condition. It's called Bohr-Sommerfeld. Quantization condition on Lagrangian. I'll explain it in a second. Yeah, so so if you have a sphere and you choose north and south and pole, and you draw as a Lagrangian various circles, and you draw capital N circles. The quantization condition is that integral of omega over upper half or lower half of the circle belongs to pi to 2 pi z. So if you divide by pi, you get an odd number. The total area is, and you get capital N circles, and this is will be basis of Hilbert space. Yeah. So that's a rough picture of quantization. If my manifold has complex structure J, so it is scalar, complex structure compatible symplectic structure, then one can be a little bit more concrete. Then the Hilbert space you define as kind of space of holomorphic section of certain holomorphic bundle, which I'll write like this. Kx is a canonical bundle. Is a complex dimension, so it's canonical bundle. Yeah, I'll write square root, which is not always makes sense, but this product should make sense as a actual line bundle. And 2 pi first chain class of E should be equal to class of omega. So this relation between this line bundle and it's like this. And so that's the definition. Let's see what was an example. Yeah, I just want to write that the scalar product is the following. If you get maybe two sections, you define scalar product as integral over manifold. You can see the scalar product pointwise. So for this I need metrization of both bundles and to multiply by volume element. Yeah, so that's the definition of scalar product. Now, what goes in compact case? It's just easy. Yeah, suppose my manifold with complex structure is just CP1. Then E will be of N. The N is the same as there. And canonical plus power 1/2 is O minus 1. And then one can see that eventually that gamma of CP1, if you make tensor product of N minus 1, is one dimension, is n dimensional. Yeah, and in non-compact case is kind of similar. Suppose my space is just C to power D, and E will be, and also kx to power 1/2, both trivial line bundle. Or x. But metrization on E is given by exponent minus sum over zi squared from 1 to d. Metrization of section 1 will be given this function. So dd bar of this thing will be give a flat Kähler metric. And on E is k to 1/2 is trivial. Then one get a kind of description of the same Hilbert space in different weights, which is Bayes and Toeplitz isomorphism. So the same Hilbert space which you saw on the left board, which was L2 of RD, can be realized as space of holomorphic functions on CD, such that integral of f squared exponent minus sum of zi squared is finite, and this will be L2 norm. Yeah, so the same space one can see as its Fourier transform functions on real variables, so holomorphic functions. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so that how one can materialize this correspondence, at least for vector space, for Hilbert space, using Kähler geometry. Not any complex manifold, not any symplectic manifold has complex structure. One can use almost Kähler structure, so it will be no condition of integrability. And instead of global sections, consider kernel of Dirac operator. Some Dirac operator, which will be Dirac operator in strong magnetic field, one could say. So in Kähler case, this Dirac operator is d bar plus d bar cross, and acts from sections, now C infinity sections of what? I have the same bundle, okay, 1/2, and multiply by d bar forms. Now consider even part of d bar forms, and mapping to the same thing with omega odd. Yeah, so the Dirac operator in Kähler case, it's d bar plus d, and it exists for non-integral complex structure as well. And then you see that if omega is 1 over h bar of some reference form, then dimension of h will be the same as for h bar goes to 0, will be the same as index. And this is equal to integral over 1 over d factorial omega 0 times 2 pi h bar to power d plus smaller terms. Okay. Now, so this so if you choose this almost Solomon-Scholes structure, you get some construction of this Hilbert spaces. Finite dimensional if the manifold is compact. Now I'll go to next things. So I assume that my, like in all these examples, I have small parameter h bar, and I have now real valued function. I will associate operator h bar to h bar, which will be self-adjoint operator. I do it by the following formula. If I have two sections, and I want to calculate matrix coefficient of my operator, by definition, it will be given by the following integral. I just substitute to this formula value of f at point x. Yeah, so it gives obviously some Hermitian form and gives self-adjoint operator. In particular, just by definition, if you get function 1, the corresponding operator will be identity operator. So the make the following claim. In Keller case, it's I think theorem of Bordermann, but in non-Keller case, it should be true, just for families of Dirac operator, is the following. If h bar goes to 0, then one have the following asymptotic expansion. So if you take two functions f and g, can consider operators corresponding to them and put to their product, they will be asymptotically equal to the following. It's consider product of two operators, yeah. The claim it will be close to quantization of another function, will be fg plus of h bar, and in fact will be sum over n greater than 0, hn bn fg hat, where what happens. So first of all, the leading term is a product. And in general, for any n, bn is made from c infinity of x, c infinity of x, c infinity of x, actually be complex valued, is a bidifferential operator. Of order nn. So it takes at most n derivatives in each argument. Then you get bn1 anything is equal to bn anything 1 equal to 0 for n at least 1. So it have no constant term. And then will be some kind of reality condition. So bn of fg bar is equal to Bn of g bar f bar. Bn of gf, fg are real functions. And finally, b1 of fg minus b1 of gf is equal to I h bar f Poisson bracket. So what you get? You get this. Let's forget about this last two things. This thing is called star product. It can be defined in any situation. We can speak about differential or polydifferential operators. Could be algebraic varieties, smooth varieties. You get a family of bidifferential operators, and it's full. There's only essentially one axiom of the star product, that if you consider sum over bn a bn fg times h to power n gives associative product on this infinite x with complex coefficients in form of power series in hbar with coefficients in functions. You extend the things to see if h linearity. So it will be see if hbar linear. The associativity is kind of obvious, obviously follows when the things come from the quantization, because product of operators is associative, and it's this kind of homomorphism is more or less faithful. But one can classify, ask the formal question, and it was the idea to study general star product was proposed by Bain, Flatov, Ronsdal, Nichlerosch, and Sternheimer many years ago. So it's a kind of big program, and I will talk about it in a minute. Just one small remark. Kind of from this perspective of star product, it becomes kind of clear why kind of question real symplectic manifolds relate to complex Hilbert space. Consider the algebra of symmetries of symplectic manifold. It's more or less the same as functions up to some finite dimensional thing. It's more or less real valued functions with Poisson bracket. Which is given by omega inverse. So this is the algebra of functions, and Lie algebras of symmetries of Hilbert space are the same as I times self-adjoint operators. It's Lie group of unitary group. And now you see that if you, in a leading term, if you see say that functions gives essentially all self-adjoint operators, then Lie bracket will be close to Lie bracket here. So we see that Lie algebras have kind of same size. They are maybe both infinite dimensional, but not isomorphic. And because they are not isomorphic, there could be no canonical construction. That's the main trouble here. So how star product look like in natural examples. Yeah, you can see the algebra. Yeah, because it's kind of pure algebraic equation, I can start with algebra of polynomials in K is a field of characteristic zero. Could be complex numbers, and M could be 2D, for example, if you think about flat space. And let's gamma. Will be constant bivector field, but not neither symmetric nor skew-symmetric. This could be not necessarily skew-symmetric. Just get some metrics. And then define Bn of Fg, define as 1 over n factorial, and take sum over I1 up to In. G1 up to Gn, gamma y out 1 J1, gamma n Gn. Yeah. One can immediately check that it gives us star product, it gives associative product. And what is basic example, if M is even number and gamma ij is equal to delta ij plus 1, so matrix gamma is kind of 0, 0, 0, and here. Identity on third block. What's the algebra you get? You can see the function and we separate variables into groups, d into d. And we associate to this f hat will be operator in replace these variables by h d on the right. We get differential operators. Yeah, so it means that each x d plus k goes to h d plus k. We get isomorphism of algebra of polynomials with differential operators. And this product, gamma product, gives just the usual product of differential operators. So the algebra is what's called Weyl algebra. Is differential operators on three-dimensional space with hbar put it in into the game. One can make another matrix, for example, if gamma is skew-symmetric. For example, here you get 1/2. Times identity minus 1/2 times identity. You just skew symmetrize the original metric. One can get something which is called
to substitute this formula. It's called Moyal product. And the main advantage of this Moyal product, it is SP 2D invariant. Unlike this product of differential operators, it's completely invariant. And if K is my ground field is R, then formally one can write Moyal product as given by some kernel, which is a bit similar to Fourier transform, exponent of I over h bar, and you integrate area of symplectic form of the straight triangles with vertices x, y, z. Yeah, it's kind of analytic expression, but if you make an asymptotic expansion h bar equal to 0, get some polydifferential operators which are exactly Moyal product. Yeah. And this is invariance, it's kind of very important. Yeah, it's Hermann Weyl algebra, and but also get Andre Weyl representation that symplectic group of 2GR acts on automorphism of this algebra is my product. Ah, by the way, it's the same Weyl algebra, but given in different bases of Weyl algebra. And this maps to up to practicization of unitary operators of L2 of RD, set projectively in RD. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so this there are two looks like two different products, but these are isomorphic algebras, and I just want to say make my small definition. What is gauge equivalence between two star product? Called product prime and product double prime. So it's given by some sequence operators and another sequence by differential operators. The gauge equivalent is a sequence of operators with Pn is let's say some C infinity x or whatever algebra we have. Differential operator of order at most n. P0 is identity, and Pn of 1 is equal to 0 for n greater than 1. Yeah, by the way, I put this condition, it's not really necessary, but it kind of shows that algebra has very clean unit element, which is 1. Anyhow, it will have some unit element, but just convenience. And such that the following. Such if consider P, which is sum over Pn Hn, or H is a certain sum. We get operator, which is invertible. That gives isomorphisms of algebra, of algebras. It transforms one product to another product. Okay. So the, what so the gauge equivalence gives the same isomorphic algebras, and what a basic tool here. This is a certain construction by Fedosov, which I will not discuss. Given any non-flat connection on tangent bundle on symplectic manifold, he produces a certain explicit star product. The basic idea is the following. Locally, manifold looks like a vector space, is a tangent space. On a tangent space, you can use Mayal product, which is commutative. And then you use this connection to glue this Mayal products. And the second thing, if one changes connection, then get gauge equivalence product, again by certain explicit gauge equivalence. So it means that you get canonical equivalence class of star products. And the theorem, one can also classify all star products with given for given x omega, kind of complex valued star products up to gauge equivalence. Are naturally in one-to-one correspondence, and the correspondence is called something like Deligne invariant. What will be invariant of the star product? It will be certain cohomology class in 1 over h bar, and consider the second cohomology of x with coefficients in series in h bar, such that this class is equal to omega divided by maybe I h bar, whatever, the things plus O1. And in particular, this construction Fedosov then class is really equal to omega divided by h bar. No correction terms. It's kind of rescaling family. So now I'll go to some kind of abstract story. So the conclusion, you get many choices, you get many isomorphic algebras. But what one can analyze, of course, if you have different isomorphic algebras, the categories of modules are equivalent. But then one can analyze, it's kind of a bit more complicated story, the claim, categories of modules over quantized algebras this algebra, maybe denoted by h bar, which is like c infinity of x. Star product. Are canonically identified. Now, for example, in this Fedosov construction, you say that you have explicit gauge equivalence, but then if you go about three gauge equivalences, if you got three things, the composition will be not identity. But turns out it will be conjugation by some element in the algebra. It will be inner automorphism that satisfies certain additional cocycle condition and uses canonical identification of categories. Yeah, so that's. No, no, for any symplectic manifold, if you consider Fedosov constructions, which depends on all connections, eventually get just one category on which, for example, simple ectomorphism group acts. So, simple ectomorphism group of X acts on this category C. Now, so what we see, we have kind of three levels of abstractions. We can get some abelian category. Maybe depending on h bar and formally, in the sense of form power series. Then we have certain algebra AH. It should be associative algebra, also depending on h bar and formula. And then we get Hilbert space, yeah? Also depending on h bar, but maybe not formally using this quantization parameter, h bar quantized, quantization constraint. And how these things are related? This relation here is like this. This category is something like H modules of the algebra. And AH, AH is endomorphism of some projective object generator, which is AH itself, take opposite. If you have category of modules, you consider one-dimensional model, consider its endomorphism group, get opposite algebra. And so that algebra is kind of category with the choice of some projective object. And the relation here is kind of essentially algebra acts on H, on Hilbert space, and maybe epimorphic there. Yeah, so that's the three different things. And what I can say about this. So there was a paper about maybe 8 years ago by Gukov and Witten. It contains some very remarkable proposal, and which was never materialized mathematically, so it's not yet realized. Even physically, it's not yet realized. It's what data you need from a symplectic manifold to get canonical construction of Hilbert space. Definitely something is missing because symmetric groups are not the same. And the additional necessary data, or maybe sufficient additional data for x omega, giving everything here, in particular h, should be the following. It so x should be totally real submanifold, kind of fixed points of anti-holomorphic involution on holomorphic symplectic manifold, and some holomorphic manifold with holomorphic to form. Symplectic form. And this thing should be kind of big, maybe complete. Yeah. So if you get kind of real manifold, let's say real analytic, it always have some small small complex manifold neighborhood. It's not a big deal. It's kind of canonical thing. But to have really big neighborhood, it's they claim that it's the data which somehow fix the Hilbert space. It's very mysterious. There's no really rigorous formulation here. And in fact, what I have to add is some small extra topological data on XC, which I will not talk about. There was actually a strange coincidence of the proposal and something which I so proposed together with Belov Canel several years ago. So it's related to the following, to the conjecture of Alexei Belov Canel and myself. And the conjecture is almost proven now. The conjecture is the following. We start just a case of affine space. That automorphism of, in algebraic sense, of C to N, C to D, with standard symplectic form, is canonically isomorphic to the some huge group. Polynomial symplectomorphisms to the group of automorphism of V algebra. Yeah. In using Mayal product, we see that there is thing is Mayal product gives invariance, equivariance under SP to DC under symplectic affine transformation. But the claim it works for nonlinear polynomial transformations, so get some canonical way. So there are several reasons for this conjecture. I will explain at the end of my today's lectures some original reasons. But with Belov-Canel, when we kind of came to this conjecture, it was using characteristic P. And the proof used characteristic P. Almost proof, which exists now, uses characteristic P. It should be different proof. And it works for real numbers. We can make real numbers here. Does matter. So the things should work over any field of characteristic zero. And then I can make kind of companion conjecture, which is related to Gukov-Witten proposal, kind of canonicity of the situation, conjecture two. Then this automorphism of V algebra, or this is the same group, should act to projective group of unitary transformation of Schwarz space so functions with rapid decay, which is invariant of the Fourier transform, which is pre-Hilbert space sitting in L2 of RD. And so this group should act while algebra acts on Schwarz space. it's a dense subspace, and conjecture that the section of symmetry group goes to symmetry of this representation. So it will be a generalization of very representations, kind of. Veil representations is action by automorphism of algebra, and also automorphism of the space. This conjecture was kind of very paradoxical. For example, this thing, if you look algebraic, it looks like inductive limits of some algebraic varieties if you bound degrees of polynomials. And Lie algebras are not isomorphic. It's exactly this functions with respect to Poisson brackets and differential pairs. But the groups somehow a bit smaller, and they don't feel this not isomorphism of Lie algebras. I think it's kind of confirmation of Gukov-Witten proposals when you see that complex manifold, maybe algebraic complex symplectic manifolds, the symmetries of this complexification will be small enough to really act on a Hilbert space. So now, after this introduction to star products, I just want to say what is the goal of my course. I will describe something different. Not unitary quantization, and not Gukov-Witten proposal, but quantization of complex algebraic symplectic manifolds. So these objects which should kind of appear in this proposal, but without anti-holomorphic involution. And the main story here is a little bit two different canonical and not fuzzy F as we have in this unitary world constructions. Kind of A model and B model. Construction of what? Of categories. So unfortunately, the whole thing it's kind of really goes to some most abstract story and to extract some numbers, vector spaces, one needs some work. So this basic example will work. If my manifold is cotangent bundled to some smooth algebraic variety, why smooth algebraic varieties? Over C. A model category is a representation of fundamental group. One of version of A model will be representation of fundamental group of Y. Not necessarily finite dimensional. One can say it's kind of modules of the group ring. And it contains kind of finite dimensional representations. It's a small part. Objects, small possible things. And and B model will be dy modules. Where dy is differential operators. Maybe just write it. global Debye modules. It's thing, and it contains as part as let's say holonomic modules, and contains algebraic vector bundle plus flat connection with regular singularities. And Riemann-Hilbert correspondence said that these two small pieces of large categories are equivalent. And equivalence is kind of transcendental, it's not algebraic. You solve, kind of do different algebraic calculation here and there. It's kind of analytic, not algebraic. And so the I'll try to say it's a bit hard to really formulate all things precisely here, that these things will be very, very general. For general complex symplectic algebraic variety, I'll have two categories of different nature, and some kind of holonomic modules will be equivalent categories. So that will be essentially the ultimate Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. Okay, so now maybe take a break about maybe 5-10 minutes. Yeah. Okay, so I'll continue. So as explained, it, I want to quantize complex varieties. So I'll now talk about star products on complex analytic first. Symplectic manifolds. And because I don't know, don't use any reality conditions anymore, so new h bar will be I times old h bar. Kind of mathematicians and bar and physicists h bar will be related by rescaling by I.
And h bar is complex.
Yeah, it will be just complex formal parameter. It will be formal parameter. Yeah, just there's really no need to write square root of minus one anymore. So first, I'll give a definition. A sheaf of DQ algebras. DQ is deformation quantization. On X is given by choose some covering, and assume that all intersections are Stein, so it's kind of holomorphically convex, some balls. I'll describe sheaf in terms of concrete terms when you choose some covering. First, on each U alpha, we fix some star product depending on on index alpha, we on algebra functions. We get sequence of B differential operators with the same axiomatics which I had before. Then on each double intersection, I should have gauge equivalence. As a sequence of differential operators, Vp n alpha beta is differential operator from the intersection to itself.
of order n.
And satisfying the same condition. And axiomatics will be the following. And
the star product is associative. It's a star product, and this is identified star products on intersection.
And axiomatic on triple intersection, on any triple intersection,
so you get something on open domain, on double intersection, and on triple intersection,
we get three star product we get three isomorphisms, and the axiom is that what I get here is identity. So it's a composed identity. This isomorphism. And so what the whole data and what it gives, and gives a sheaf of algebras over form power series. Sheaf, I don't know, maybe called something like H A H. And plus isomorphism and go to which algebra should be free, topologically free CH modules. And space of generators, sheaf of generators will be identified. It will be part of the data with OX as sheaf of algebras over complex numbers. Okay, so that's, and it's obvious how to, this notion of kind of gauge equivalence of such things. You get the same shifts and isomorphism given again by some sequences of polydifferential operators. Yeah. And I think it is hard to classify. Not unlike in, in the real case, it's there was this classification result which shows it's this formal path in second cohomology, and in complex case it's more like in real case. The reason why. Ah, by the way, I just forgot to say that associative product and are alpha, and if consider commutant this Poisson bracket appears as the first term. Yeah, that's a constraint. Yeah, in principle, one can forget about this constraint, think about star product, and to get just some Poisson structure on your manifold, not necessarily symplectic one. But even in symplectic case, it's hard to classify. The reason locally, all star products in symplectic case are equivalent to each other. So it means that if you give a star product, then classification is given by H1 of X with the coefficients on certain sheaf of groups. Will be, and groups will be automorphisms of AH given by polydifferential, by gauge equivalences. Self-equivalences, which gives identity automatically, in this case, modulo h-bar, because modulo h-bar we identify with functions. And This automorphism group, it's very of this gauge equivalence. It's actually in the symplectic case, it's very easy to classify it. The sheaf of group is the same as sheaf of invertible elements in this algebra modular center. And this is non-abelian group. So it's kind of hard to make deformation theory with non-abelian group. There's no clean answer. And the idea is to replace, kind of modify a little bit the equation. So we get this automorphism, maybe this sheaf of AH. It's a sheaf of groups. It's replace these things, replaced by kind of automorphism of category. Instead of automorphism of algebra, I consider automorphism of category, which is something called crossed module. It's like two-step complex of non-abelian groups. This placed in the homological degree 0 and degree minus 1. And here we get AH inverse. And if you substitute this number, you see that it's the same as C of H bar inverse placed in degree minus 1. And it's completely abelian. Shifted by 1, homological degree 1. And it's completely abelian. Yeah, so it means that one should kind of modify a little bit the equation. What is the modification? It's some very simple word. Definition is an algebraoid over some commutative ring R is an R linear category, which is non-empty, and all objects are isomorphic. Yeah, so it's pretty. This category is many isomorphic objects, it's, you can replace by categories one object. If you have categories one object, you get algebra over R. If one object, you get the same as associative algebra over R. But to have different objects, you get isomorphic algebra. Since algebras are not canonically isomorphic, you choose some isomorphism. Yeah, so it's little modification. So it's what is similar to? It's similar to notion of groupoid. Imagine like you have a topological connected topological space. Then for each point you get fundamental group, and this group are not canonical isomorphic. You choose a path between two points, so you get a category where all objects are isomorphic and each object has automorphism, monoid, which all morphisms are invertible. And this is called groupoid. And this is kind of, instead of group, I have algebras and called algebraic. And if you have algebra, you get category of modules. And if you have algebraic, gives abelian category of modules of it, which are functors. And if you choose one object, it will be equivalent to R modules, to A modules. A is endomorphism of this category of any given object in algebraic.
All this is in symplectic case, or it's just Poisson?
No. This story, it could be done in Poisson, this thing as well, yeah. But even in the symplectic case, I claim the story is complicated. Uh,
Yeah, so I get. So the idea is that kind of modify the story. One can make kind of parallel definition. Is sheafs of maybe algebraids. I want to make a sheaf of algebraic broids using the star products. It will be slightly different story. So I get on each open set, I get star product. On each intersection, I get gauge equivalence. And now, maybe just put it in other colors. It will be modification algebraids. Now, this axiom will be replaced to some additional data on each triple intersection. This composition, which I have between three algebras, composition is not equal to identity, but equal to adjoint action by some certain element, which I should have to add to the game. It's new data, f alpha beta gamma. F alpha beta gamma, it belongs to algebra functions on u alpha, u beta, u gamma, this product, say, product prime, and it should be invertible element. So I get a invertible element, and then I'll get an axiom will be the following. On each quadruple intersection, it's kind of a bit messy to write. What I get one can denote elements of intersections vertices of triangle, then for each face one gets certain invertible element and plenty of isomorphisms and product of four elements f these things is equal to 1. Instead of before it was composition equal to identity, now I have corrections and go to next cohomological level. Yeah, it's next cocycle, yeah, story. And it's a modification. And then it gives the following. It gives a sheaf of algebraids. hbar, and in particular sheaf of categories of modules, and plus equivalence modulo hbar is ox. Yeah, so that's this kind of more tricky object, but this description of parameters, it's much easier. It will be essentially the same as real story. Yeah, so what is nice here, we get this sheaf of categories, we get global objects, so we can speak, we get certain categories, something like modules of deformation quantization, as also there's no algebra around. And now I just want to say this theorem. So the first thing, it's in this work of
algebra, it's so general notion that you can start not necessarily with Poisson's break, just any Poisson, not symplectic structure, any maybe degenerate Poisson structure. And then it's kind of hard result. Result it's kind of formality in my formality theorem and deformation quantization that any for any complex Poisson structure you get canonical sheaf of algebraoids. Deformation quantization sense. It's like in Fedot's theory, rescale Poisson structure. Yeah, you just rescale Poisson structure and make this linear family. Yeah, that's its kind of black box. And depends on the choice of associator in Drinfield's associator. In fact, there are many, several canonical constructions. This is Gallo group action, Gallo group. Bar Q, whatever, or Grothendieck Müller group acts on such constructions. So, for example, to way to associate to Poisson structure star product, it's in a sense not there are some hidden universal parameters one can modify it in one way to another. Yeah, yeah. So it's and the formulas are. Very unavailable, but.
Now, what do you mean by black box? Is it a proof or the?
It's a proof, but it's kind of it's theoretical. For example, things you cannot really calculate because Feynman diagrams are not known, and yeah, so it's theoretical result. Yeah.
That associator is related to this cocycle, right?
No, not at all. Not at all. Yeah, yeah, but anyhow. In general Poisson situation, if one get some star product and this maybe DQ algebraic, one can twist in some simple way any sheaf of algebraic, any sheaf of DQ algebraic by element. In H2x C of H bar by this second homology. Just in symplectic case, all various sheaves of algebraids obtained by from the canonical one by twists. Yeah, so they're really parameterized by twists. All sheaves of DQ algebraids twists applied to the canonical sheaf.
The result 2 and 3 are coming from this construction?
2 and 3, no. This is notion of algebraic. It's some kind of nice story, but which replaced deformation theory by the simpler guy. That's it.
Okay, this comes from this one. No.
It's theorem. I don't know. I didn't explain where it's come from and how it's proven. Yeah. It just for your information, in a sense. It's not the theorem to prove. Yeah. Yeah, so this is a black box, and but in fact, 2 and 3 in this theorem can be described independently in symplectic case using kind of Fedot's construction. Yeah, it was written in papers by Kashiwara and Shapira, and but we are not alone. I also I remember the period when Fedosov construction arises. I also kind of made it for myself. Yeah, so it's pretty easy. So one shouldn't go through this deformation criterion. There's no doesn't depend in the whole story for symplectic case. It doesn't depend on associator. All these horrors are completely irrelevant. Okay.
Will you explain what is a twist?
Twist? No. No, I will not explain. Yeah, but So the answer will be essentially the same as in the real case. In the real case, I say that you. This classification of star product algebraic equivalence is H2 of Rx with form power series in H bar. And here it's kind of the same story. As a twist, it's essentially the twist is the following. You choose your cycle on triple intersection to get constant function. At least it's really, really easy. If you get certain psi alpha beta gamma, which is in a constant C, which R star, you modify, unfortunately erase my thing, phi alpha beta gamma to phi alpha beta gamma multiplied by psi. Yeah, that's a twist in terms of cycles. And the fact it's cocycle guarantees the thing is okay. Yeah, so twist it's really straightforward in terms of this covering. Sorry?
You said that it's not connected, that the stories are connected to cocycle.
Cocycle, which cocycle?
The one you called phi.
It's connected. Yeah, it's connected. Yeah, twist acts on this. Okay. Yeah, so what is the role of twists? Yeah, in fact, this. Again, one can make the. It's a bit longer story. Suppose you get a cotangent bundle with this standard form. So we get, by all this story, we get a sheaf of algebraids. And in fact, it will be sheaf of algebras. But the claim it is not equal to the naive DQ modules. Yeah, so you have coordinates xi on maybe xi on y, and consider expressions h, di, and x. Get sheaf of algebras. It's not this naive sheaves which exist on cotangent bundles. So don't get differential operators or micro differential operators. And that the twist is twist parameter is a certain class in the second cohomology. Which class? It pull back a certain cohomology class on Y. And which class on Y? You consider pi I. Sorry, it's number I still appears in the game. Of this first chain class of canonical bundle of Y. So again, we get kind of half canonical bundle here, which sits in H2. This element sits in H2 maybe X C model 2 pi I Z. and it's two torsion class. So twice the sinkers will be equal to zero. It's the torsion class, which can be maybe sorted. You consider two, some four-dimensional Adzumai algebra over Y representative. And C mod 2 pi I is H2 of X C star, which sits to H2 of X C of H bar star. Yeah, so it's two torsion element. It's actually zero if. Sorry? Which is my algebra? Because when I consider square root of line bundle, it doesn't have to be existence given the class of H2 on C star, coefficient is plus minus 1. And you can make a certain Adzumai algebra for this.
This is square root of KY.
Sorry?
This one is square root C1 of KY.
C1 of canonical bundle of Y.
Where this square root comes from?
2 pi, why it's not 2 pi I? Why it's square root? Yeah, it's, first let me say that it's zero if there exists square root of canonical bundle in Picard group of Y. And what is the origin of square root? It's some kind of calculation. But let me explain basic idea. The whole story was based on Moyal product, Fedosov quantization using Glunk Moyal product. And let's do, suppose we get some Moyal product, we get maybe variables xd and y1, yd, which before I denote by consider Moyal product. And consider expression f, which is, assume that f is linear in y. So it should correspond to vector field by quantization. Yeah, let's just do two variables. And consider x n y for any n. What will be differential operator corresponding to this function? The Moyal product is given by kind of symmetrized product. And if you see what is symmetrized, it's equal to x1 dx. I put also h bar equal to 1 for simplicity, plus xn minus 1 dx x. You average over all possible ways to put differential operator in the middle, because my hat will be dx. And now we calculate it. What is it? You get xn times dx and plus 0 plus 1 is n divided by n plus 1, xn minus 1. And what is this guy? Is equal to n times n plus 1 over 2. So we see that the sink is equal to xn dx plus 1 half n xn minus 1, which is xn dx plus 1 half of divergence of the vector field on the line. And this is this 1 half and this 1 half are kind of explained one another. Yeah. So that's the basic calculation behind how we get this square root of. So there is this small kind of problem with this twist, which appears all the time. And I will not go, let's assume that we kind of learn this twist story, so to this little modification
of what naively one can see. Now let's proceed. Get sheaf of categories of modules over this algebraic, DQ algebraic, and suppose we have a global object. We say it is called holonomic if it is locally kind of flat or free, topologically free over form power series, which has deformed something over hbar, and coherent sheaf over Ox at hbar equal to 0. So we get deformation of coherent sheaf. In this case, kind of simple claim, dimension of support of this model M, whatever M, Fm model Hm, is at least D, which is half of complex dimension of X. And support is always quasi-tropic. And model is called holonomic if the support is Lagrangian, which means it has the smallest possible dimension at any point. So we see this kind of these holonomic models, which eventually appear in this Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, correspond to Lagrangian subvariety and maybe some vector bundles on them. Remove this TV story. With the star products, I explained that for locally they all look the same. If you know symplectic structures, they're all isomorphic to each other. And there is something similar for holonomic modules. X will be smooth analytic, kind of complex analytic Lagrangian. Manifold. Then locally, there exists unique up to isomorphism holonomic DQ module said that its classical limit is isomorphic to functions on Lagrangian submanifold. That's a really easy calculation. You just first construct this model and see that it has no deformations. So in local coordinates, and again, we introduce some coordinates xi, yi, this Lagrangian submanifold will be like this, and given by this equation. Then algebra, whatever I denote, at least germ of the sheaf of algebras is the following. I consider analytic functions in x1, xd, and also in hd1, hdn. Not necessarily polynomials, could put h bar. And this module
And ML is, oh, sorry. This function one variable. And what is automorphism group of this module? Locally, it's just multiplication by constants. Then if my twist parameter is equal to zero, one can study what are local objects on Lagrange manifolds, which I locally isomorphic to this guy, and turns out that these global objects on L locally isomorphic to ML. It's again first cohomology of some sheaf, but it's kind of a little bit twisted story. It will be line bundle on L maybe formally depending on parameters. Plus flat connection on what? Maybe multiply by spec. Line bundle depending on parameter and flat connection also depending on parameter on maybe called M classical on M classical tensor int canonical L to power minus 1/2. So this line bundle will be not of degree zero but of degree half canonical class. And what does it mean? In principle, there's no choice of square root. It's equivalent to flat connection on M classical square root multiplied by KL inverse. Yeah, this will be honest line bundle, and you choose a flat connection on it. Yeah, so that's the case when the twist is non-zero. And if X is a cotangent bundle, and we use twist by K y to power 1/2, if you want to get differential operators, so if you want kind of du modules.
In this case, it's always reduced to the linear in Y situation, or no?
Linear.
You had linear differential operators. I mean, x to the power n times y. You took the.
No, it was from my previous situation. Yeah, I eventually to reduce to this action of vector fields. Yeah.
It will be to the action of vector fields.
Yes. Yeah, because in case of cotangent bundle, the symmetry is only functions in vector fields. Yeah.
Reduced to vector fields.
Yes. Yeah, but differential operators. Anything. I just want to say that you get a flat connection on M classical multiplied by KL minus 1/2 in times pullback of KY to power plus 1/2. This one can analyze. Yeah, so it looks kind of pretty abstract, but in fact it's thing which is very well known in differential equations. It's called kind of WQB. Maybe it's called Voros sheaf. I think, something like this. Some people call it Voros parameters. Yeah, that's yes. Let me tell you what does it mean it in real case, real life. Suppose, let's say y is a curve.
you get y, you get cotangent bundle to y, these fibers by vertical fibers, and then you get your subvariety L, which is usually called spectral curve. And assume that L smooth and projects to Y with only double ramification. No. It's not integrable system. It's just one equation. It's just one equation depending on parameters. It's not integrable system. So it's you get such a picture, and when you lift to some modules, you get kind of d h bar y module holonomic d module depending on parameter on h bar. For example, you write some equation, something like h dx square plus blah blah blah, some v of x besides it. You write things like this, and then it then classical limit you go to hyperelliptic curve, you get this the story. Yeah, so if you get this equation depending on small parameter, then you get this various ramification points for alpha, and sum of r alpha is exactly difference between S divisor on L is difference canonical class of L minus pullback of canonical class of Y. And it's even number. It's divisible by 2. We are lucky for the curve. It's divisible by 2. But in principle, nobody guaranteed it. And all this stuff will be the same as representation of fundamental group of L minus the set of ramification points to C of H bar star, such that if you go around any ramification point, you go to element minus 1. Yeah, so, and how it arises in real life? What is this local system you get? Yeah, so you get this my spectral curve and this foliation. And this DQ module outside of ramification points is isomorphic to standard module, because you write this locally. L is graph of df for certain function. Function is defined up to constant. And you can see the standard DQ module, which is a little bit small. You can see the exponent of f of h bar multiplied by locally. It's sheaf of modules. Analytic functions in x. And take series in h bar. Yeah, so you can guess what is the module in coordinates in this way. And it doesn't make if you change f to constant, you get canonical standard module. And the set of isomorphism will be torsor over c h bar. So and then if you go around, you get some representation of the fundamental group, which is kind of very well known procedure in differential equations. And you get a differential equation, you get for any loop, you get invertible element in series in h bar. Yeah, so it's just want to say that it's all this abstract categorical nonsense with twists. It eventually goes to very concrete geometry. And now I'll just finish with few words about non-formal quantization. Yeah, so it's that's before what everything, essentially everything she wanted to tell about formal quantization. What about non-formal? Mm. Now, so the story is that here we'll have no sheafs. Yeah, so it's pretty long, pretty different story. Yeah, if we have algebraic symplectic manifolds, or some field K, it's not always be quantized non-perturbatively. And what is the what's the problem? This abelian category or algebras, whatever modules, locally can do something, but there's a problem when X is not compact. Problem at infinity of X. There's kind of no control for h n terms when n goes to infinity. Yeah, just kind of naively. Suppose X is a fine space. And suppose we really deform the whole algebra. Then we get something like X2D. We get product on this guy. But the problem, if you consider coefficients of high powers of hbar, there will be polynomials of high degree in X. And from this it seems to be this should be somehow controlled. And in order to control, behave at infinity, one should choose a compactification. And suppose it's Poisson compactification, and X will be open symplectic leaf. Then this deformation quantization story says it's everything will be fine. One can maybe get a definition of kind of good category, good DQ modules will be coherent on DQ modules over h bar. And here one should use deformation quantization for Poisson manifolds in full force, and mod out by those supported at infinity. And then you get something more reasonable, but I think maybe I better stop now and continue next time. Yeah.